Let's open with a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you for today. Lord, we thank you for this place you provide us to come together just to give us, to give you glory with our voices, with our talents. So Lord, let us open our hearts and our minds and our spirits and just give you praise this morning. We thank you again for each one that's here and this time together. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, here we go.
All the day long.
This is good to see everybody this morning. We've just want to remind everybody of all of our service times. Our Sunday services begin at 8:30 like we're doing right now. We have another service at 10:30, and then this evening, Transform Ministries at 5. So you're invited and welcome to come join us on Monday mornings at 10 o'clock at Jackie Farrell's house. There's a women's Bible study. Monday evening at 4:30, women's Bible study here at the church. And then Tuesday, we don't have anything. Wednesday, Thursday, prayer of the pastor here at the church at 10 o'clock. Everyone's invited and welcome to come. There's prayer request cards on the back table. You can go to the website, Daisy City Cowboy Church, and do a prayer request on any page there. And those prayer requests come to us on the email. And then we have prayer of the pastor again at 10 o'clock Thursday mornings here at the church. Everyone's invited. Everyone's welcome. Home group at Mary Gary's house Thursday evening at 5:30. So there's our weekly schedule, so come and join us every chance that you can. We look forward to all the things that God's going to do in your life as we join together to give and glory. Amen?
Amen.
All right, well, let's see. Anything else coming up? Nothing else coming up really with this summer? The heat is going to get hot sooner or later. Don't know when that's coming, but be ready. Amen? All right, here we go.
Did I get all I need? Did I love all I could love? Did I live all I could live? Was my faith in your grace strong enough to save me? Did I do all I could do in the time that you gave me? In the time make him turn away every time I stood in my ground. If the days and years you should decide to take me, did I do all I could do in the time that you gave me?
Computer. You notice how things don't really seem right. Well, last week the computer crashed between morning service and evening service. So I didn't have one last Sunday night. So our computer guy came and got it this week and got it all fixed. And he called me yesterday, said, I'll meet you at the church at noon. So he came down here and he hooked it all up. Well, it's still not all, it's working, but it's not She needs a little help. So hopefully by next week, we'll have it all helped out, okay? Get it going again. Those technical things are good until they quit, and then they're not good. They're not good to get back where they used to be. They don't conform really. End up with a headache, go ahead, yeah. All right, so let's worship with our tithes and our offering. Gary, you got a couple of help. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for today. And Lord, we just want to remember and thank you for everything that you do in our life. Sometimes it's a bump, sometimes it's a bruise, and sometimes it's the greatest blessing we've ever received in our life. And so, Lord, we just want to acknowledge you in everything, that through everything in our life, it's a blessing from you. All good things come from above. And so, Lord, we thank you how you bless our lives. And, Lord, we want to give back to you a portion and worship you this way this morning, to give back to you as you've already blessed us with. So, Lord, I ask this morning that you bless the gift and you bless the giver and you bless this offering for your purpose, for your honor, and for your glory, that the word of Jesus Christ, the truth of life, would go out among the world through this. And we thank you again for the opportunity and the privilege to serve you that way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Every Sunday this month. So, Barry, if you've got a song, we can begin to play it. And we can begin to look at some scripture. The book of John, chapter 6. This is a one chapter of the Bible that just really speaks. It's got all the elements of the gospel in it, and it speaks to me in a lot of ways. So I want to begin reading in verse 53 and through 58. Then Jesus said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life, and I will raise him up in the last day. For my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. As the living Father has sent me, I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me. This is the bread which came down from heaven, not as your fathers did eat manna and are dead. He that eateth of this bread shall live forever. And in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 28, the scripture tells us that let a man examine himself. Let us take a moment and consider what Jesus is telling us here. That if you believe that the Son of Man was sent down from heaven and was crucified and tortured, and his body was broken and his blood was shed, and he was crucified, he was buried, and God rose him up on the third day, and that resurrection provides life, as he says, whosoever partakes of me and partakes of life. And this is eternal life. This isn't a life that is sustained by nourishment until it finally comes to an end. This is a life that is sustained by the blood and the body of the Lamb for eternity. So in order to receive that worthily, we need to believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead. We need to believe in our heart that every word of the scripture is true. And we understand that what we are partaking of is the body and the blood of the Lamb, the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. The life that he gave is through this, that we would receive life. So as they pass out the elements, we're going to take a moment of silence, a moment to just stop and ask God if there's anything in our life, anything that you know, as Paul is, Peter wrote, help me in my unbelief. If there's anything in our life that is separating us from God right now, that he would reveal that to us, that we could in this moment of quiet time and confess that. Confess the life of the body and the blood of Jesus Christ that we could receive this morning, all that he's done for us in this, that he would be glorified and we would be worthy. So take a moment now. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning in verse 23, Paul writes to the church, and he says, I received of the Lord that which I also delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. Lord, we want to give thanks this morning. Right? We just want to come this morning and want to humbly bow before you this morning to receive your body, to receive life through your sacrifice. And Lord, we thank you that we could be here today and that we can have life, eternal life. And we can live in that eternal life today and for eternity, because of what you did through your broken body. So Lord, we thank you for this bread. We thank you for what it represents, the broken body of the Lamb of Jesus Christ. Lord, we just ask you to bless it this morning, that we would receive all that you have for us. And we thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen. He broke it and he said, take eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me, in remembrance of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who take the bread. After the same manner also he took the cup. Lord, this cup, it holds what represents the spilt blood that you shed on Calvary's cross, on the road carrying that cross up to the hill of Golgotha. The blood that was shed as they scourged your body with cat of nine tails, and the blood poured out on the ground. What is in this cup represents that blood. And we thank you, Lord, for your shed blood. We thank you for what you endured, that we could have life. For your blood is drink indeed, according to your word. So we thank you for it. We give you glory in it. After the same manner, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as you drink it in remembrance of me, in remembrance of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He took the cup. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he comes. Until he comes. There was a poet by the name of John Lindgate. And he penned the phrase that out we are familiar with Abraham Lincoln quoting. You can please some of the people all the time, and you can please all of the people some of the time, but you cannot please all of the people all the time. I think about the things that are going on in the world around us today and the things we see happening, and in my prayer time and in my time to just meditate and think, I remember a time when I was a lot younger and things were a lot different, and I tried to aspire to understand what has transpired that has caused our world to be in the condition that it's in today, and where is it going? You know, we look back and say the good old days, because we cherish the way things were when we were younger, and I believe that's probably true for every generation as generations have come and gone, that it was better when I was younger than it is when I got older. People are crazy today. Amen. They weren't crazy when I was a kid. They just got that way over time. And it wasn't me, it was them. Everybody else got crazy. I'm still good, right? You know, but it's amazing how different we are. And this difference, the difference of opinion, difference of philosophy, difference of ideas, is what begins to separate us and divide us and causes us to look at things from a different point of view. And I thought about the things in life that apply to every person that make us the same, but causes us to be different. And I believe there's one thing that is been part of everybody's life at one time or another, maybe still today, and will be a part of everybody's life from now until Jesus comes back. It's something that causes the largest amount of contention among people, and yet we all seek it. One six-letter word that we've all sought after, we all seek after, we will, I guess, for all our days, then our grandkids will do the same. And that's to be accepted. Accept is to consent or to receive. Accept, by number two definition, is to believe or to come to recognition, to recognize as valid or correct. Now, when I got that definition and I read it, believe or come to recognize as valid or correct, I look up the word valid, and valid means be based on truth or reason able to be accepted. So the two kind of work together. Now everybody wants to be accepted. That's what we see out there, as we see everywhere today, is they just want to be accepted for who they are and what they are and how they live, whatever. They just need to be accepted, and nobody needs to condemn one another. And the Bible tells us not to judge one another, to let someone live the way they want to live, and not to be judgmental of people. And whoever they are is who they are. And we all have a desire to be accepted for who we are and not be judged by anybody else. And yet that one desire to be accepted is what I believe causes the largest contention among people. Because one doesn't want to accept what the other one believes. One doesn't want to believe what that one believes. One don't want to, well, you can't be right. Everybody went crazy but me. It's amazing. By using these two definitions, with these definitions, we see that truth can validate acceptance. So everything that wants to be accepted is validated by the truth. And see, that's where the problem comes in. Because I'm sorry, but there's only one truth. You're entitled to believe and do whatever you want. That's the freedom that was given to you by the good Lord above. God Almighty Himself gave you the freedom to choose and to believe whatever it is you want to, but it doesn't make it the truth just because you believe it.
Amen.
There's only one truth. John 14, verses 1 through 6. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, that you may be also. And whither I go, you know the way. But old Thomas jumps up and says, Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know neither where thou goest, how can we know the way? Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. There's only one truth. There's only one way that anybody's ever going to get to heaven and live there permanently. See, the Bible tells us that there's going to be a great white throne judgment, and everybody will be part of that judgment. You're going to get to heaven. The problem is, how long are you going to stay? I'm excited about eternity being there, amen? I don't want to get up there to that white throne judgment knowing I'm on my way out. But there's only one way that you get to stay eternally. There's only one truth. And see, this is where the contention comes in among mankind, is that we want to be accepted for what we believe, not for the truth. But by very definition, to be accepted, it has to be validated, and validated is by truth. But the truth is sometimes kind of hard to swallow. Now here's Thomas. The disciples, they've been following Jesus, they've been walking with Jesus, the whole time he's been on here, and he's fixing to leave. And he tells them, okay, I'm going to go, and you guys can follow. Well, I don't know how to get there. I don't even know where you're going. Well, you've been following all this time. How many times did he tell you where he's going? He didn't say, he said, come on, guys, let's go. And they just went. And now he said, okay, I'm going to go, and then I'm coming. And all of a sudden, Thomas is like, oh, what? I don't understand. And by not understanding, he's stepped away from the truth of knowing that Jesus has directed his steps ever since he's been down here. But he stepped away from it and said, well, it doesn't make sense to me. It's not going to make sense to me. No one here can even begin to understand what eternity is. We have no concept of eternity. We know what it means, but we have no idea of that span of time. We have no way to perceive that in a way that is real, that we can really get a grasp of. We have to accept that by faith, that eternity is really there. That there really is an eternity. There really is an eternal life. We have to accept that by the word, by the truth, see? It's validated by the truth. Now, when we can accept the truth and say, you know, I'm not sure how all that works. I'm really not sure what eternity is. It sounds really great. And I really want to see it. I really want to know it. I really want to live in it. Because, see, you can experience eternal life here. We don't have to wait for that to happen someday. The truth is, when you accept Jesus Christ, you believe in your heart, you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, your eternal life begins at that point. You can rest assured you're never going to die. The old body's going to wear out, it's going to give up, but I'm going to live forever. I'm going to live forever, and when this body wears out, Jesus is going to take me home. And I will be with Him eternally. Because of the body and the blood of the Lamb of Jesus Christ. Because of what He did on Calvary. I have to have faith in that. I can't look at it and say, well, I need to be accepted for who I am. Okay, well, you can do that down here. And you can argue about it, and you can fuss about it, and you can go on and on, but there's no truth in it. See, if there's truth in what you believe, then there's no confrontation. I don't have to be accepted. Jesus has already accepted you for who you are. If you really want to be accepted, if you really want to feel like you can be accepted for exactly who you are, then get on your knees and Jesus will accept you and you'll be His for eternity. And you won't have to worry about being accepted anymore.
Amen.
Jesus says, no one can come unto the Father but by me. So when I've accepted Jesus Christ and He's accepted me already, hey, I'm accepted. There's nothing more to be accepted of. There's nothing more to want. You already have eternal life. I was talking to a guy this week, and he was talking about ministering to somebody, talking to somebody, and their response was, well, I have to believe what you believe in order to get to heaven. No, you have to believe the truth. I'm not saying that I'm perfect. I'm not saying that I have it all right. I'm not saying that I have anything that is the truth, but the Bible does. And the Bible will speak to you, and the Word of God will speak to you. And as you read through this Scripture and you learn of the Lord, He will teach you the way that you need to go, and that will be the truth in your life. The truth is not of me. The truth is of God. The truth is what Jesus did. And He tells us in His Word that if you accept that and you believe that, as He has accepted you as a sinner, you can accept Him as your Savior, and all the accepting to be done is done. You know, society teaches us that you don't really need to be too bold, because you could become alienated. If you speak out against certain things, then that's not good. People won't like it. And you don't need to go telling everybody about Jesus, because you could offend somebody. They might be offended by that. So you have to be careful of where you go and how you say it and what you say. As, you know, just society teaches us that you got to stay safe. You don't need to be out there stirring things up. But the Bible tells us that if we're ashamed of Him in public, He's going to be ashamed of us in front of the Father. You know, God calls us into a place that gives us opportunities to do things for His purpose. Not for a benefit of us, but for a benefit of what I have accepted. I've accepted the fact that God sent His Son down to be crucified, and through that I was saved, and now I have accepted that. So I need to be willing to share that with somebody, because that's the truth. And if they accept it, then they'll have the truth, and they won't need to be accepted anymore. They won't be out there looking for something that nobody can give them. All the people out there in the world that are trying to be accepted, even if you accept all that they do, they're still not going to be happy. They're going to need to do more. It's just a push for more and more and more and more, because it's never fulfilling, because there's no truth. It's not validated. They do marches, all kinds of different kind of people. There was people marching yesterday in Phoenix, and they march and they march and they march and they march. And has anything changed? It's still the same. It's the same as it was in the days of Jericho. It's the same as it's been all through the scripture, all through the Bible. It's always been that way. If you want to be accepted, accept Jesus Christ. Because He's already accepted you. He's already died for you. He's already given His life that you would receive eternal life simply by accepting what He's done for you. See, Thomas immediately replies in a negative. Well, I don't know. Okay, I'm already lost. You told me you're leaving and I can come, but I don't know how, so I'm already looking on the negative side. See, things come in our life and God puts us in a place to do something, and immediately we turn to the negative, just like Thomas, like, well, I don't know, Lord. We went to they had a potluck over at Quail Run on the 4th of July. We went over there, and it was pretty full, and there was tables for people, and so Des and I picked the table, put our stuff down, and pretty soon this other couple come, and they put their stuff down, and they sit down, and we begin to eat, and we begin to visit. And the guy, Rick, begins to tell me how he was a young boy, and they were a poor family, and they went to this, they were going to this church, and he'd accepted the Lord, and he was excited, and it was time, the Sunday would come, that he was going to be baptized. And so he was going to go to church. Now, this was about 35 years ago. He was going to be baptized, and he went to church that Sunday expecting to get baptized. And the pastor came up to him and said, look, there was two ladies of the church that were going to be baptized that Sunday also, and they were very, very prominent people. And they told the pastor, we're not going to get baptized with him. You'll have to do him next Sunday. So he went to the boy and he said, look, these ladies are getting baptized, so we'll baptize you next Sunday. He hasn't been in church since that day. He was rejected instead of accepted. But see, Jesus still accepted. And for 35 years, he has read the Bible and studied, but he hasn't been in a church, hasn't been in a congregation, hasn't fellowshiped with Christ. He's just been studying all by himself. And as we began to have a conversation, began to talk, it occurred to me that he just wanted to be accepted. Regardless of who he is, regardless of where he was, he doesn't need to be told what he's done wrong. Jesus said, I came to the end of the world to save the world, not to condemn the world. So I visited with the guy and just shared with him who my Jesus is and how Jesus accepts everybody. There's not anybody that he turns away. If you come to a place in your life that you say, I really need to have a security of eternal life. I really want to be there. When I get to that white throne, I want to know that I'm going to be there forever. That he's preparing a place for me, as he said in his word. That if I accept him as being the only way, the only truth, my acceptance will be validated and I'll spend eternity with God. And that's all I need to know. That's all I need to know to live here and be able to live my life. That I can accept everybody else that God puts in my path. That whoever God puts in my path, whoever God brings into your life, you can accept them with the same acceptance that Jesus accepted you with. And not be judgmental. And be able to turn that judgmental part away and say, there's something here. See, there's something in everybody. There's something in every person out there that you'll ever meet that they're seeking to be accepted for.
Amen.
And when they understand that Jesus Christ has already accepted them, and they receive that acceptance, all of a sudden their desire to be accepted is fulfilled. Because it's filled with the truth now. And all the other things begin to diminish and go away. It's the truth that will make you free, Jesus told us. The truth is what will help you to understand who you are and that you've been accepted by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. the one that God sent down so that you would be acceptable through his blood and through his body. That's the truth that validates acceptance. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Verse 18. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. The things that aren't obvious to you day by day by day, the things that you can experience in your spirit, and the truth that you have of who Jesus is, those are eternal. These things here, they're not eternal. They're temporary. They're only going to be here for a while. Hebrews 11, verse 1. Blind faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. I don't need to see where we're going, Lord. I don't need to see where this life ends up. I don't need to see anything. I don't want to be like Thomas. I don't want to be doubting. I want to trust you. I see by the example of Thomas that my carnal response is going to be right away, well, how do I get there? You get there on your knees. One trip on your knees and you're on your way. And he will guide you every step after that. There will not be another need. There will not be a desire to be accepted. You will have already been accepted. See, I believe even in a lot of Christian people don't realize they've already been accepted.
Amen.
If you've trusted the Lord Jesus Christ and you've given your life, you've already been accepted. There's nothing else. You can't make it look better to be accepted more. There's nothing about you that has to change except your heart. The only change that has to happen in your life is you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of Man. I believe that he was crucified, and I believe that God rose him on the third day so that I could be accepted. Because in sin we're not acceptable to God, but through the blood of Jesus Christ we are acceptable. He made us acceptable by his truth. We just have to receive it. We just have to come to a place in our life and our life where we're willing to receive it and be accepted exactly for who you are. Nothing has to change. Well, Pastor, I gotta do a few more things before I can give my life to the Lord. You can't change it. Only he can change it. Only through being accepted by him and realizing that you've been accepted will you ever change. Matthew 24. This is where we find ourselves today. 24:10-13. And then they shall many be offended, and they shall betray one another, and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. Does that define your news at night? It defines it to a T. Then shall many be offended and shall betray one another and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall arise and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. When we see people out there, we have this thing that came along, I don't remember when, maybe in the last 15, 20 years, maybe even longer, I don't know. Hate crime. Isn't crime a hate crime of any kind? It doesn't matter what it is. You don't do mean things to people because you love them. If you're doing mean things, it's because you have animosity and anger in your heart and hate. That's where it comes from. It doesn't have to be labeled as a specific type of crime. It's crime, period. It's wrong. It's sin. There's not a caliber of sin. And there's not a caliber of crime. Mankind has developed a caliber of all kinds of things, and even that, and we just continue to try to refine it. Excuse me. But I wonder how many news people would be willing to read those three verses out of the Bible. It would be amazing, wouldn't it, if your news came on in the evening time and it said, Matthew 24:11-13, and that's how they started. And then they told you the rest of it, because it all lines up. It all falls in that category. It all happens that way. Verse 13, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. He that realizes he's already been accepted, and you will endure all these things, you will be saved. Because you've been accepted. My grandson's practicing his preaching. Getting warmed up. Offended because they're not accepted. Not unvalidated because they're not. There's no truth. See, there's only one truth.
Amen.
There's only one truth. And through that truth, you can be validated and accepted and receive eternal life, beginning the moment you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth. Now we're going to go right back to where we started in the book of John chapter 6. We finished off at verse 58. Beginning in verse 59, John 6:59, I'm going to read through the end of the chapter. These things said he into the synagogue as he taught in Capernaum. Many therefore of his disciples, when they heard this, said, this is a hard saying, who can hear it? When Jesus knew in himself that his disciples murmured at it, he said unto them, does this offend you? What if ye shall see the Son of Man ascend up where he was before? It is the Spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit, and they are life. But there are some of you that believe not. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were that believed not and who should betray him. And he said, therefore said I unto you, that no man can come unto me except it were given unto me, given him of my Father. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Then said Jesus unto his 12, will ye also go away? Then Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life, and we believe and are sure that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered him, have not I chosen you 12? And yet one of you is the devil. One would not even, out of the 12, didn't even accept. Would not accept. The 12 that Jesus handpicked. It sets the stage for where we stand today. It sets the stage for who we are today and why life is the way that it is, and lets us know that it's not going to turn around and go back. It's not going to be like it was in the 50s. It's not going to be like it was in the 30s. It's not going to be like it was in the 80s. It's a forward motion. And it continues to go. And it continues to give us opportunity to be a witness for Jesus Christ in the places that we go and the people that we see, because you have been accepted already. Well, I don't know if they'll accept what I had to say. It's already been done. If God put you in a place and an opportunity to share the gospel with somebody, God has already prepared the time and the place and the ears to hear. And they would receive what you had to say. Well, I told them about Jesus and they just got up and left. That's okay. You're just a sower. You just plant a seed. God will make it grow. Some will accept, some won't. But you're accepted. You've been accepted. There's nothing more to desire than to be accepted of God Almighty through the blood of Jesus Christ. You've been accepted. If you've given your life to Jesus, you're already accepted. There's nothing to want. There's nothing to desire. There's nothing more. This might sound like a crazy statement. There's nothing more to life than to be accepted by Jesus Christ. That's the truth. And in the truth, you'll be validated and accepted of him by him. And there's no other way. There's no other way. You've got a couple of songs we're going to close with. You've got a couple of... Stay forever. If you don't know that for sure in your mind this morning, I plead with you to make that choice this morning. To leave this morning knowing that you've been accepted by Jesus Christ. Knowing that you've been accepted by God through the blood that Jesus Christ shed on the cross. And walking every day of your life, every day from here forward, knowing that you've been accepted. And in the confidence and the boldness of knowing that I'm a child of God. And when that day comes and I come to that throne and the judger says, what have you to say for yourself? You can say, I've been accepted through the blood of Jesus Christ. And walk in that confidence beginning today. If you've never done that before, you can do that right here, right now. You can come up here, I'll pray with you right here. You can ask Jesus Christ to forgive you of your sins and to come and live on your heart and to guide your life and believe in Him this morning and let Him guide you. One simple little prayer right here together today. And you can be accepted and have that confidence for eternity, forever. Never to be taken away. Nothing can pluck you out of this life. If you're just letting me in. Come and be accepted by Jesus Christ. He's already accepted you. Come and accept what He's done for you. Anyone at all this morning, just step out and walk up. And we'll pray together right here. You can accept what Jesus Christ did for you on the cross that day. And be accepted eternally. Anyone at all this morning, just step out and walk up. Step out and walk up. The hardest step is the first one. After that, you made up your mind and the Spirit takes over. So would you come this morning? Anyone at all? Anyone at all? Come and be accepted and accepted. It's that simple. It's that easy. To receive eternal life. Anyone at all? Father, we come this morning and we thank you, Lord. And we give you glory. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your truth. And we thank you that you accept us each and every one. And those that are here today that are confident and sure of their acceptance, let them go out, Lord, and share. They're the one they need. That everyone can be accepted through the truth. Validated in their life. We thank you, Lord, for this time together. We thank you for each one that's here. And we give you glory and we give you praise and thanksgiving in all things. Lord, is in your name that we pray. Amen. Let's all rise. The Lord bless you, and the Lord keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you, be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance and give you peace. May you go to peace and in confidence, and in confidence in your salvation. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. God bless you all. We love you all very much.
Not good. It's really, really.